Good morning, everyone. My name is Rebecca Langmead, and I want to thank you for joining us today here in SFU's West Gymnasium for the celebration of life for Dr. Lorne Davies, Simon Fraser University's founding athletic director, who passed away on Friday, February 27th, at the age of 84. Almost 50 years ago, in 1965, Dr. Davies became the first athletic director and football head coach at Simon Fraser University, and almost immediately began masterminding some of the most forward-thinking measures in Canadian university sport. He hired full-time coaches, promoted female participation in university sport, awarded athletic scholarships to student athletes, and took the clan on a path to compete in the United States against American competition in the NAIA, offering student athletes access to the American athletic experience and a Canadian education. These core values continue to drive Simon Fraser University clan athletics today. Dr. Davies chose the original clan colors, blue, red, and white, and often told audiences that blue represented loyalty, red was for courage, and white for integrity. He grew the athletic department from three programs to one of the most successful university athletic departments in the country, with 17 men's and women's programs. A familiar figure around campus, Dr. Davies continued to serve as executive director of the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award Program after his retirement as athletic director. He will be deeply missed, not only by his family, but the entire SFU community. For those of you who are unable to be here with us today at the Lorne Davies Complex, you can pay your respects by sharing memories of Lorne for the Davies family on our SFU Athletics website at athletics.sfu.ca. The Davies family requests that in lieu of flowers, donations be made to the Lorne Davies Endowment for SFU Athletics. This fund provides scholarships to the male and female athletes of the year, in addition to support for SFU student athletes. I personally have had the opportunity to meet Lorne on a number of occasions and was humbled by the experience to meet a man who is considered to be a mentor to many of us student athletes here at SFU. Please join us today in celebrating the life of Lorne Davies.
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, I'll ask that you please rise for the procession as we celebrate the life of Lorne Davies.
Please welcome the six-time
world champion SFU pipe band. Be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the celebration of life for a truly great man, Lorne Davies. My name is Farhan Lalji. I'm a reporter for TSN, but I also had the privilege of working for Lorne here in the SFU Athletic Department from 1991 to 94 as the school's sports information director. And there are so many words that come to mind when you describe Lorne. I think of passion, loyalty, integrity. I think of trailblazer. Even bravery for a man who decided to set out on his own course. And it's my honor to be a part of this event. I'd like to thank his lovely wife, June, who Lorne always referred to as his child bride, to his sons, Lorne Jr. and Glenn, for allowing me to be a part of this event. I was involved with Lorne's retirement from SFU in 1995. I was also fortunate enough to be at his 60th anniversary just under a year ago. And just Lorne's passion for life, his passion for his family, and his passion for Simon Fraser University always stood out. Now, Lorne will be deeply missed, of course, by June, Lorne Jr., Karen, JR, Sonia, Brielle, Chris, Morgan, his other son Glenn, Melody, Michael, Ginny, Crystal, Daryl, and Isaac. But June has given me strict instructions. This is not a day for sadness. This is a day for celebration. And when I mentioned all the traits that Lorne had, I didn't mention sense of humor. He did have one. You may not have seen it, but how else could you explain how long he kept Zenon employed? You ever see that office? Most of Lorne's laughs came behind closed doors, but they were always loud. They were always hearty, because for him, everything he did at Simon Fraser was just a pure labor of love. It was pure joy. And as people who've been around this university since 1995 when he retired, you'll know that he never left. First with his work with the Terry Fox Humanitarian Foundation, but just generally being here and providing advice and opinion and anything, you know, whether people wanted it or not, Lorne was going to provide it. You know, because this university meant so much to him, and the success of this place meant so much to him. And probably the biggest word that comes to mind for me is impact, because he impacted all of you. He certainly impacted me. He impacted a province. He impacted a country. He impacted how we view athletics. and that will be one of his many legacies. I had a chance to MC the gathering of the Klan on Monday morning, and I said that Lorne gave me my first professional butt chewing. I think I still feel it. He gave me a few, and I'm sure a bunch of you are thinking right now, oh yeah, he gave me one too. But you know, we all got past it, and it made us better. It really did. And I'll tell you a story, which may or may not be funny, but 3 years into my tenure at Simon Fraser, I loved my job. I loved my job as sports information director. I made $23,000 a year back in 1991. And I think 3 years later, I made like $24,000. Okay, it wasn't much different. But I loved it. Just the university atmosphere and the collegiate athletes and people trying to strive for greatness and excellence. I think I could have done it forever, probably for the same money. And one day, near the end, Lorne was really upset at me. It was a minor thing, but to him it meant a lot. He got very angry. And I came back, you know, a day later, and you know, I had a chance to think about it, and I thought, you know what, it's probably time to move on. A month later, I got a job in radio, and from there went television, and here I am today. But about a month after I left, Lorne and I went out for lunch. And I never told him that, you know, that last butt-chewing had anything to do with me leaving, because truly it didn't, but it was kind of a catalyst. And he was fully aware of that meeting. And he said to me when we had lunch a month after I left, he said, I want you to know something. I was hard on you, but I knew you were capable of more, and I knew you were getting comfortable here, and it was time you spread your wings. And at that moment, I realized that so much of what had happened, there was no guesswork. He knew what he was doing. He knew that day what he was doing and what it meant, and if it wasn't for that, I wouldn't be here today. And I think many of you who are here feel the same way. He knew. And as you move along in life, and you athletes will know this, at some point you're going to graduate. At some point you're going to get your first job. At some point you're going to move on and get your second job. And as you move up in the world, regardless of what you do, people are going to say, I'm proud of you. But for some reason, whenever Lorne said it, it meant more. And over the years, I've had a chance to see him at SFU events, or he would call and we would talk, and he would always say that to me. You know, that you do a great job and I'm so proud of you. And it meant more than when just anybody said it. And I think that speaks to the impact he had on me. And I know many of you sharing that same story, but they feel the same way. That it just meant more because of probably what he accomplished. We've got a great speakers list for you today, a number of people that played for Lorne, a number of people that worked with Lorne. Lorne and his family were people of great faith. We'd like to start the evening, or the afternoon, or the morning, by introducing Pastor Dave Register.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, Farhan, for that wonderful introduction. Thank you to Simon Fraser University, and for all of you coming here today on behalf of the Davies family, welcome to our celebration of life for Lorne Davies. And what a life it was. Lorne lived a full, rich, and rewarding life. Most of us here knew him as a friend, an athlete, a coach, an administrator, a director, a philanthropist, a husband, a father, and a grandfather. He even got to spend a little time this past year with his great-grandson. But I knew Lorne Davies as an exemplary Christian and a fellow elder in the Church of God. I was sitting in my office in California preparing a sermon when I received the announcement of Lorne's death. I knew I had to come here today. The next morning, June called me and asked me to share with you what Lorne believed about life and death. The first time I met Lorne and June Davies was in 1971. As newlyweds, my wife and I were invited to their home for dinner. They were so hospitable. They had a very happy family. Their example impressed us. And on our way back to our apartment in Burnaby from their house, I remember commenting to my wife that someday I hoped that we could serve and love the way the Davies did for us. It was shortly thereafter that I was called into the ministry of Jesus Christ, in part because of their powerful example. Of course, many of you here knew Lauren as a Christian as well, because he unabashedly lived his faith. It has been said the best sermon is the one without words. The sermon of a Christian example. The coach, as so many called him, would often advise his players, co-workers, and friends, God first, family next, then your job. That was the way he lived his life. He put God and God's laws first in his life. Shortly before his death, as he was growing physically weaker, his daughter-in-law, Melody, asked him, "Are you afraid of dying?" He replied, "Not at all. I know God has a game plan for me." Lorne not only lived his faith, he died in faith. Solomon, the wisest man to have ever lived, wrote, "To everything there is a season, a time for every purpose under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die." Solomon was describing the cycles of life and death, and Lorne, of course, was keenly aware of these cycles. In his lifetime, he saw the cycle played out many, many times. He thought deeply about the purpose of life. In the book of Job, we read, "If a man dies, shall he live again? All the days of my hard service, I will wait till my change comes. You shall call, and I will answer you. You shall desire the work of your hands." God indeed has a game plan for Lorne Davies. Lorne knew that God was working in and through him. I'm sure that's one reason his heart was so dedicated to serving the needs of others. He believed that men and women whom God called, forgave, and bestowed his spirit upon were God's people. He believed that God was building righteous character and godly fruit in his life, preparing him for a future life, a special life in God's kingdom. Oh yes, God has a game plan for Lorne Davies. Job wrote more. "For I know that my Redeemer lives, and he shall stand at last on the earth. And after my skin is destroyed, this I know, that I shall see God for myself, and my eyes shall behold him. How my heart yearns within me." Lorne believed in the resurrection of the dead. This belief motivated him, it drove him, it gave him great faith in God. He knew God had a game plan, and he was a part of it. The Apostle Paul wrote, "But someone will say, how are the dead raised up? And with what body do they come? Foolish one, what you sow is not made alive unless it dies first. But God gives it a body as he pleases. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown incorruption, it is raised incorruptible. It is sown in dishonor, it is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness, it is raised in power. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body." Lorne believed this as part of the game plan that God had for him. Lorne believed that death is like sleep. He closed his eyes after a full and rewarding life and is now peacefully resting, awaiting the resurrection into a spiritual body, not a frail, weak, and worn out body. His next thought will be the excitement of the resurrection with a new spiritual body. The Apostle Paul continues, "In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, for the trumpet will sound and the dead will be raised incorruptible. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death finally is swallowed up in victory. Yes, God has a game plan for Lauren, and he wins the biggest game of all. In fact, God has a game plan for all of us. Lauren lived for the hope of the resurrection to eternal life. That was what his faith and his life were based upon, the hope of the resurrection to eternal life. In his letter to the Thessalonians, Paul wrote, "For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Therefore, comfort one another with these words." Naturally, we will miss Lorne Davies, but we will see him again with his new spiritual body in God's kingdom. If you'll bow your heads, I'd like to pray. Father, we come before you, humbled in the presence of the cycle of life being ended for Lorne Davies, as we celebrate his life here today and all that he did and all that he brought us. We thank you, Father, for his example. We thank you, Father, for his calling. We thank you, Father, for what he has done for you in serving you in your way. We now, Father, commit him into your hands, and we look forward to the time, Father, when you will rejoin his spirit with a spiritual body, as he believed. We ask now for your comfort upon the family, particularly upon June, that you, Father, would be with them and comfort them with the knowledge of your plan for Lorne Davies. Again, Father, we now ask for your blessing upon all of us who will miss him, particularly upon the family, and we do this again in the name of and by the authority of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Dave. I'd now like to ask our Senior Director of Athletics and Recreation, Dr. Milt Richards, to open the ceremony.
I bring greetings on behalf of President Petter, Vice President Driver, and all the coaches, staff, faculty, alumni, and friends at Simon Fraser University. I only have the pleasure of knowing Lorne for about 3.5 years. But you know, when you take a new job and you move to a new country and you don't know anybody and you walk into your office and before you get there you see this sign, Lorne Davies Complex. And then you say, you know, I think I need to meet this Lorne Davies. Well, then you look at the phone and it's ringing and it says, Lorne Davies. So he said, Milton, I just want to welcome you to British Columbia and to Canada and to Simon Fraser University. And I just want you to know that I want to help you anytime I can. And I said, Mr. Davies, he said, no, it's Lorne. And you know, from that point on, I can't tell you how many times I really had the opportunity to talk to Lorne. And I remember when I was hiring the first football coach or even the second football coach, Lorne called me and said, you know, we have this big process. And one of the things we did is we'd have a really nice dinner over at the Hilton and be kind of a gourmet dinner. And that's when Lorne would come with me, and it'd just be Lorne, myself, and Ed Jaskula, the general manager at the Hilton Hotel, and we'd sit and talk to the football coach, and you know, at that point, I'd want to get Lorne's blessing on who was the best coach. Well, this time around, Lorne called. He said, you know, I'm a little sick. I'm in the hospital, and I don't think I can make it, and that really bothered me. And then I kept checking in with him, but then about, I want to say 3 weeks before he passed, he called me and I really wanted to ask his advice about a situation, but it wasn't the right time. I could tell Lorne was close to moving on. But June, Lorne was such a special person, and I'm just so glad that you and your family decided to hold the memorial here. And there's so many people. June called me Sunday morning to tell me that Lorne had passed, and Wayne Holm had already shared the news with me. But so June called me and she said, do you think we could come up and meet on what we might do? And right away, Gloria Chu, Peg Johnson, Eugenie Coe, Chris Arnett, just everybody, my office, Kelly Weber, Mark Pope, we had this huge meeting, and the result was this wonderful, wonderful celebration. I know Lorne's looking down on us now, and I know maybe we'll win a few more games because of Lorne's help. Thank you.
Thanks, Milt. Our next speaker is Judge Jim Jardine, who was a charter member, or a member of the SFU charter football team. He was actually recruited by Lorne to be the program's first ever quarterback, but after his freshman season, he got switched to defensive back. He was a corner and became one of the leaders of this team's defense throughout his career up here on Burnaby Mountain. After graduation, Jim became a lawyer and was appointed a judge of the provincial court in 1997. Ladies and gentlemen, Judge Jim Jardine.
Good morning. June, I am honored to have been asked to speak about Coach Davies. It is my privilege to be here today, but I'm here on behalf of two other JO grads who came to SFU 50 years ago as well, Rob McLaren and Bob Smith. We were part of the charter class of 1965, and I am proud to say how many of those charter students have returned here this morning to honor Coach Davies. You've seen the sign. He chose colors, red for courage, blue for loyalty, white for honesty and integrity. That wasn't a long reach for those of us from John Oliver because our colors had been red and blue, but they had not been structured for those purposes. Coach Davies went through phases, reinventing himself in each one, as Pastor Bob has already described for us this morning. He was an athletic director and a football coach. He then had involvement with the community, with the Terry Fox Foundation. He sort of retired, but he didn't. And then he continued to network, because those of you who are here today will all know that he was pushing for a campus stadium. This building bears his name. When we started here, this building was merely a mud and gravel parking lot where I parked a 54 Volkswagen when it made it up the hill. He networked all of his life. It is impossible to network successfully without the trust of others. He remained true to his dream throughout his career, and his was a life well lived, full of energy and commitment right to the end. I'm not here this morning to talk to you about the 1965 start, the Trout Lake Trot, or the later experience of 38 of the Hills, when we lost a game rather badly at Portland State. I'm here to give a tribute on behalf of the charter students that I represent here this morning to a man who will always, to me, be coach. It is what I've called him for 50 years. I was never comfortable with Lorne. It was just too familiar, and it did not express the respect I felt for him. Coach Davies lived his message. His message as a coach, administrator, and educator was expressed in philosophical life lessons. There were many messages, but the word pride comes to mind. He taught us that high-level athletics develop discipline, confidence, commitment, diligence, and dedication. We learned to believe in ourselves. We learned that the foundation of success is hard work. He used to talk in word lessons, letter by letter, with us, and I have prepared this morning on that basis. He was fiercely proud of this university. He was fiercely proud of his family. He was one of the most loyal men that I ever dealt with. He was personally caring and compassionate to me in the last few years where I've had some health issues, and he demonstrated yet again that it is all about caring for each other. But his persistent commitment to excellence was to drive us to be the best that we could be. Those platitudes that just mean exactly what they say when the tough When it gets tough, the tough get going. Have the courage to push through, even when you think you can't. The motto of this university comes to mind as one of his life lessons. Be proud, be prepared. Nous sommes prêts. The letter R is about respecting yourself. If you respect yourself, you can respect the others around you. Can you look at yourself in the mirror in the morning and say, I'm doing the right thing? You have a responsibility to yourself, your team, and your community. You might ask yourself, what is your intended service to your community? Because that's what he modeled. Integrity, intensity. Do what you're going to do with intelligence, honesty, and integrity. Live it and bring it. Exercise discipline, dedication, determination. Without persistent determination, little that is difficult can be successfully achieved. Be that person. He taught that to me. He taught that to many of those with whom I played. I know that Dave Cutler and Glenn Orris are going to follow me, and we were all part of that 60s team that learned those lessons. Boy, did we learn those lessons. But more importantly, and the true measure of the man was developed in the emotion, the caring, the compassion, and the fact that under the letter E, we had to earn it. He modeled it in the hard work at this school. He modeled it with education, because we had study hall at night. And I don't know when he was ever home, because he was here when we got here at 8 in the morning, and he was still here when we finished study hall at 9:30 at night. And the first year, we were going at it 6 or 7 days a week. So thank you to the family for giving him to us and letting him teach us. I cannot leave this morning with also invoking the modeling that he and June taught to all of us as we had left this school and interacted with him as adults. They modeled a marriage that should be an example to us all. They modeled a community involvement where they utilized their love and support for each other for the benefit of all of us. The courage and the fortitude of Coach Davies in the face of a devastating diagnosis was a testimony to the true measure of this man. He never lost his sense of humor. The day before he died, he was still connecting lightly and lovingly with his life partner, June. One could do well to emulate this example. Rest in peace, Coach Davies. You've earned it.
Thank you very much, Jim. Our next speaker is Queens Counsel Glenn Orris, who was a right cornerback on the first ever team. Now, in 67 and 68, the SFU secondary featured three men, Jim, Glenn, and the late Rick Sugden, who ended up practicing law a mile from each other. Just shows you that the type of men Lorne recruited to SFU were doing the right things academically. Ladies and gentlemen, Glenn Orris.
June, I want to thank you for the opportunity to say a few words today on behalf of Lorne Davies. In preparing these remarks, I found out something that stunned me. When Dr. Gordon Shrum tagged Lorne Davies as this university was getting completed in 1965, when he tagged Lorne to develop and create the athletic department, Lorne was not yet 35 years old. Gordon Shrum could have chosen anybody across the country, and he tagged Lorne Davies. When I came to Simon Fraser at 17, I was somewhat anxious that I might measure, whether I was going to measure up. But I can't imagine, or I can imagine, the anxiety and the pressure that Lorne must have felt having taken that responsibility. And it wasn't a situation where he could say, well, I'll just look at other universities in the country and follow their lead, because his mandate was to set up an athletic department, recruit people to it that would revolutionize student sport in Canada. And that's what he set out to do, and that's what, in fact, he did. Now, I want to talk about Lorne as a person, because after the university was built, and after the academics were put in place, and after Dr. Gordon Shrum and Dr. McTaggart Cowan went on to do other things, Lorne stayed. He stayed here. And he stayed here, I believe, because he realized that he wasn't building a university, he was building people. And of course, we know that that's much more difficult and takes much longer. But that's what I believe Lorne did and continued to do basically throughout his life. Now, the pitch that was made to me to invite me to Simon Fraser was, come to this new university, play football, and we'll pay your fees. Seemed like a good deal to me. What I didn't realize at the time, though what Lorne Davies and the coaching staff at the time were saying to me, the real pitch was, come to the most beautiful place in the world to be. Come and have a university experience that is really second to none. Meet a truly amazing bunch of guys with whom you will bond and with whom you will be proud to call friend, and you will be humbled by the fact with Lorne, that we all, with Lorne, still and always will care about one another. You will get an education and a training that will allow you to continue on to do whatever you want to do and accomplish whatever goals you set for yourself. Now, that's what Lorne Davies gave to me. And I believe that's what he gave to hundreds and hundreds of other student athletes. There's nothing that I can say other than thank you for that to him. I got to tell you, my first experience about meeting Lorne Davies, or actually seeing him, I was geared up, ready to go to my first practice, anxious as heck, in the meeting room in the next gym, as a matter of fact, just outside the dressing room. And Lorne Davies came in. It was the first time I'd seen him, other than head and shoulder shots. And my first thought was, he's really short. I can tell you that that was the first and last time that thought ever entered my mind. As my coach, I can tell you that I really can't say at the outset that I liked him. And I say that, don't get me wrong, absolute respect right from the outset. But like is not necessarily a word that comes to mind when you're talking about your first experience with a coach. And, you know, in fact, I could probably go further and say that, you know, on the 11th of, I remember it being 25 hills, just over here as a matter of fact, it may have entered my mind that, in fact, I didn't like him, you know? But those are the experience we had. And I should tell you, rest assured, whether it was 38 or 25, none of us did all of those. You know, none of us did, except maybe Jim. Because Jim and Lorne had very much the same personality. And the personality is, if you're going to do something, you do it till it's done. And that's what Lorne did throughout his time here at Simon Fraser. But I should tell you that The love and affection that I feel for Lorne and, of course, for June and Lorne and their family came later when I realized what he had given to me and allowed me to do. And I want to just move ahead a bit in time. And after I'm through university and I'm sitting in my office dealing with my law degree or my law practice, and I mean no disrespect, but I have no idea, of course, what Moses felt when God talked to him. But occasionally, there'd be a phone call. Hi, Glenn. It's Lorne Davies. I wonder if you could help me with something. I wonder if I could help you with something. All the anxiety I felt in my first day at Simon Fraser rushed back each time I got the call as to whether or not I would measure up. But of course, it was never about helping Lorne. It was always about helping someone else, and in the vast majority of the cases, helping the university, because that's what he was committed to doing. Now, I learned late last fall that the University of Manitoba had bestowed an honorary doctor's of laws on Lorne in June of last year. I didn't know that. He had never told me that, but that's the kind of person he was. So when I look at the title on the program today and it's Dr. Lorne Davies, somehow it just doesn't ring right to me. You know, it doesn't sound right. And I mean no disrespect, but Coach, as Jim talks about, Coach Davies, Lorne Davies, that's what I know him as, and that's what he is to me. Because he really, when you experience Lorne Davies, especially in the kind of experience that those of us in the football team early on had, he really became, as we all did with each other, your friend. And I don't have many friends I call doctor. So it's always been Lorne. Now, I want to say this. Lorne has left us his legacy. But he's also, in my view, left us a job to do, and that's to ensure that his legacy is maintained and enhanced. This is a great university, and we can all take steps to make it better. So, in closing, just let me say this. Hi to all of you. It's Lorne Davies here. I wonder if you could help me with something. Let's all measure up. Thank you, June. And thank you, Lorne. Thank you all.
Thanks so much, Glenn. Terry Fox was a student here at Simon Fraser University and a member of the junior basketball team prior to losing his right leg at the age of 18 to bone cancer. Lorne was one of the first people who went and visited Terry right after his surgery. And when Terry was raising money for the Marathon of Hope, it was Lorne that paid for his plane ticket to go to Newfoundland to get it all started. Lorne's last public appearance was right here, back in December, when we raised Terry's number 4 up to the rafters. And he told the story right here at Center Court about the impact that Terry had on Simon Fraser. Terry's brother, Fred Fox, was at the ceremony and is here with us today.
First of all, I just want to say how extremely honored I feel today, June, and your family for inviting me to speak on behalf of Terry and our family and our connection to Lorne. I want to acknowledge that my dad, Raleigh, my brother, Daryl, my sister, Judy, and my wife, Teresa, are here as well today. So thank you, June, for allowing me to be here. Terry did come to Simon Fraser in the fall of 1976. Months before, he had decided that he was going to play university basketball. The problem was the coaches here didn't know who Terry Fox was. They didn't go and watch him play high school basketball. They didn't recruit him to come up here. But others felt that Terry had no chance of making playing up here as a walk-on athlete. As we know today, because of Terry's guts and determination, he proved that he did belong here playing basketball. What had thought to have been maybe an injury during that freshman year turned out to be Terry was diagnosed at 18 in 1977, March of 1977, with a type of bone cancer, and he would need to have his right leg amputated. Before Terry's diagnosis, Lorne didn't know who Terry Fox was. This was completely understandable. Lorne was building an athletic department at Simon Fraser. It was a young university. Lorne couldn't possibly know every talented young woman and male athlete up here. It just wouldn't be expected for him to know all of those athletes. And I believe it was the men's basketball coach at the time, Stan Stewartson, who went to Lorne and said, "Lorne, Alex Devlin and I have a young guy on our JV team that's struggling and battling with cancer." Lorne went to Royal Columbian Hospital to visit Terry and introduced himself to Terry for the first time. That began a relationship with Terry, our family, and Terry's dream that lasted just a few days short of 38 years. Terry wasn't going to let this latest challenge slow him down or stall his education. So he asked Lorne if Lorne could talk to his profs and have books sent up to the hospital to Terry so he could continue learning. And that's what Lorne did from that point forward. He continued to help Terry. I think Lorne saw that commitment and work ethic in Terry that he hoped to see in every Simon Fraser athlete. Lorne continued to support Terry before, during, and after the Marathon Hope. Terry passed away in June of 1981, and Canadians wanted to do what they could to continue Terry's dream. Our mom, who had no public speaking experience, was now the one who was out there sharing Terry's story and carrying the torch for Terry and our family on behalf of our family. Lorne became a great support for mom and was there to advise and assist as needed. In 1982, a year after Terry passed away, the Canadian government established a scholarship award called the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award, and they were looking for individuals across Canada to form a board of directors to oversee the scholarship. Mom and Dad were asked to come up with a couple of names in British Columbia, and because of Lorne's passion for Terry's story and with his obvious connection to university, Lorne was a natural choice. Lorne was a board member for 13 years, and then after he retired here from Simon Fraser, he became the executive director of the scholarship program for almost 20 years. I honestly don't think I formally really met Lorne until 1994. I was the provincial director of the Terry Fox Foundation in British Columbia and the Yukon, and at that time, Lorne was leading the charge to organize the Terry Fox run here. That event continues all these years later, every September, because of Lorne starting it. I attended with Mom Lorne's retirement dinner from SFU back in 1995. Mom, it was so important for Mom to be there, to be there to recognize Lorne and to say a few words about Lorne Davies because he meant so much to her. It was Lorne who was responsible for the statue that is now sitting here at Simon Fraser, and that happened in 2001. And for many years, Lorne would sit in his humanitarian office, Terry Fox Humanitarian Office, and every day see Terry from his window. The day that the statue was installed, Lorne said this: "As Canadians, we are relatively conservative and we don't brag very much as people. We have humility. But here was this young guy who captured the hearts of Canadians by valiantly running across Canada, not for any personal glory, but to raise money for cancer research. Over the years, Mom and Dad got to know Lorne and June a lot better, and I personally got to know Lorne and June better over the last 5.5 years. Mom was also a board member of the Scholarship Award, and she was starting to step back a little bit, and she and Lorne asked if I would attend the meetings in 2009 and 2010. And that's not my comfort area at all, and being around people who are so much more knowledgeable and what's going on around the world and everything else. But Lorne was there to make me feel so very much comfortable. Mom passed away in 2001, and I'm now a full member of the board, and I've grown to keenly love that award, scholarship, and that's because of Lorne. I can never imagine that I'll ever be as passionate about the scholarship award that Lorne was. Lorne was always there to listen, to make you feel a part of the discussion, and that you had something important to add. I've learned a lot from Lorne Davies in a very short time. I love to listen to Lorne share stories about folks he had met and the pride he had about Terry Fox Scholars and the athletes that he had coached who had gone on to professional careers. Lorne was always the first to talk about the virtues of others. Seldom would he talk about himself. Last June, I had the pleasure, as already mentioned, to be in Manitoba in Winnipeg at U of M to see Lorne receive the honorary doctorate. And there was Lorne accepting this honor, and he talked a lot about different things about his life, but for most of his speech, it was about Terry Fox. That's the way Lorne was. Okay, so before I continue, I need to tell everybody that my favorite Disney character is Donald Duck. And my family, my wife would probably say that we share the same personality. And the reason I'm telling you this is this. During one of our conversations with Lorne, it came up that Lorne had spent a short period of time, I think 1960, 61, at the University of Oregon. University of Oregon has been the American university that I've followed the last 20 years in their sports. And so we chatted a little bit, and so instead of just having this connection, Terry connection, we now have the University of Oregon connection. But I asked Lorne if he knew about the Oregon Ducks mascot, and he said he didn't. And I began to tell Lorne that in 1940, without Disney knowing, that the university began using Donald Duck as their mascot. It took until 1947 for Disney to figure out that they were using Donald Duck. And the athletic director at the time, in 1947, sat down and met with Walt Disney and was able to come up with a handshake deal that they would use, they were allowed to use Donald Duck moving forward. And then I said to Lorne, he said, Lorne, you know, that University of Oregon athletic director, he didn't establish the first scholarships, athletic scholarships in Canada, and he didn't, get women's sports to be competitive women's sports and universities started equivalent to men's, but gosh, getting a handshake deal with Walt Disney was pretty good. So Lorne thought that was good. I think he would never let you know that that he didn't like what you were telling him. He was always there for you and supporting you. My wife and I, Teresa and I, we were very honored back in September to be invited to June and Lorne's 60th anniversary get-together, the reception at the home, and then later on at the restaurant. And after dinner, many of the athletes that Lorne had coached had the opportunity to get up and share their memories of Lorne and the impact that they had on their lives in and out of sport professionally. And I missed the opportunity to share that Lorne also spent 20 years making a difference in the lives of young students across Canada who otherwise might not have had an opportunity for a post-secondary education. June played a significant role beside him all those years as well. I live about 5 minutes west of Lorne and June in Maple Ridge, and I will always regret not taking them up on the offer of going for coffee after I walked our dog up at Raleigh Lake in Mission as I came back through. Having dinner with Lorne and June on December 6th, and then coming here to the gym and being with Lorne and my family on that day that they retired Terry's jersey will be a memory that'll be etched in my my mind forever. And it was such an important day, and Lorne was so proud to be here and honor Terry as well. Connected to the Terry's jersey retirement, Lorne said in an interview, he said, "Our colors at SFU are red for courage, blue for loyalty, and white for integrity, and I picked those myself. And every one of those ingredients was in the makeup of Terry Fox." Lorne Davies also had those qualities. And our family will always be so thankful to Lorne and his longtime connection to Terry. Anything to do with Terry, he was a big support. And I know Terry and Mom will be right there beside Lorne from this point on. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Fred. Although I'm surprised that Lorne didn't kick you out of his office when you talked about the University of Oregon. He wasn't a fan of other universities. One of my good friends, Nadine Caron, who was a member of the SFU basketball team, she played in the early 90s. The basketball team once traveled to Arizona to play in a tournament. She came back and she was wearing a University of Arizona sweatshirt. And he called her in and said, "You take that off right now, young lady. Do you think anybody at Arizona is wearing a Simon Fraser University sweatshirt?" She sheepishly went, "Change shirts," and had the right colors, but Lorne was all about loyalty to SFU. Thanks again for that, Fred. Our next speaker is Dave Cutler, who was a member of the team in 1965 here at Simon Fraser. He played for 4 years until 1969, and he perfected his toe punt kicking style, which allowed him to play for 16 years in the Canadian Football League. He won 6 Grey Cups with Edmonton, and Dave is considered by many to be one of the greatest kickers in Canadian Football League history. Please welcome Dave Cutler.
Isn't it awesome, waiting for the next word? June, boys, thank you. This is a pleasure for me to do this. Jimmy talked about being recruited. Paul talked about being recruited. I shall get to that. Let's give you a picture of 1965. The Mustang was in its first year. The Canadian flag, when Simon Fraser opened, was 6 months old. Gas was 29 cents a gallon. Houses in Coquitlam were $21,000. And the quadrangle had 3 sides. The people that came through the door that year, there was 4,800 came through the door of Simon Fraser that year. And Simon Fraser had been put on the map. The first money that was allotted for Simon Fraser was in April of 1963. On the top of Burnaby Mountain was nothing but, I'll be short. The only thing on top of Burnaby Mountain was trees, cougars, animals. And an oil pipeline they were still waiting to put across it. There was no fields. There was no pool. The pool was not finished yet. There was no dressing rooms. And the only thing was Joe's office, Lauren's office. He had that put together already. What they did, how I got here, and this is the point that I wanted to make to Jim and Glenn. I mean, these guys were rich guys. Joe actually came and saw them. "Would you like to come and play for us?" Me, I was on a boat going from Victoria to Seattle to get some shoes. They had these fancy shoes called Riddell. And if you put them on, they made you 30 miles an hour faster. And while I was on the boat, football was over for me in Victoria. I was 19 years old. And I was on the boat, and this guy came up to me, and he said, "Oh, are you going to the Simon Fraser camp?" And I said, "What's Simon Fraser?" We live on an island, by the way. And so he said, "Well, yeah, they're having tryouts this week in Vancouver." So I went from Seattle, with a knapsack literally on my back to Vancouver. I caught a bus down Hastings, hitchhiked from Hastings up the hill here, and went up to the offices that were theirs. And I said, I'd like to come and play for your football team. And he looked at my giant 5'10", 180-pound body, slower than most people, and said, we have a tryout starting tomorrow. Now that tryout, everybody here has probably heard about that first day. There was 195 people, for those that haven't heard this story, there was 195 people first practice trying to make this football team. Second practice, there was 90. Apparently all the people that had left were IQ over 85. It was unbelievable. It was unbelievable. The practices were somewhere between an Olympic workout or forced marches at Alcatraz. Practices were harsh and demanding. They challenged all of us to reach inside. Most of all, to find the edge of who we were. We've talked about hills. The hills were like this. Glenn said he didn't run them all. Well, when your brain goes dead halfway up, you stop counting. You did them all. Because Jimmy was right behind you. But those hills were unbelievable. And what it did was that for us band of brothers that were there, we made it possible for each of us to do it. None of us liked it, but everybody made it possible for everybody else to make sure that we got through. And with that band of brothers, we became warriors. We had to be warriors to stay. There was no faint hearts here. And that band of warriors, it's just like you talk to old veterans. Once you've shared adrenaline, and you've got people that all paid the price with you, it doesn't matter how long it goes between when you actually did the deed to when you meet again. It's always the same. The switch just gets turned on. And that was because Joe forced us. And I call him Joe and Lorne. He forced us to reach down inside places that nobody could get to. We stepped through the doors of adulthood together, and oftentimes we stepped backwards too together. We shared adrenaline with people who were going to be lifelong friends, and there were going to be people that stuck with you forever. Man, oh man, this is... Joe's program was the foundation of our ability to go to the wall. Every one of us here has had to go to the wall, whether it's health, business, family. You have to go to the wall at some point in your life. What he taught us to do was to go to the wall and keep moving regardless. He taught us the survival gear. And there were practices, I'm not kidding, he might be up in front of Judge Jimmy for some of those practices. But the thing that's most important, and I mean this absolutely, is that we and his program, he taught us to reach inside and go for the peace that you might not even realize is there. So he showed us more about our souls and the abilities that we had as people that we probably would never have done. And also, he showed us what a watch was about. He didn't call it a watch, but it didn't matter where you were on that team. Whether you were somebody that never dressed, or you were the guy that was throwing touchdown passes, everybody was the same. It was like a watch. There's no important piece in a watch. You take one out, you don't have time anymore. So he made it all equal and all about who we were. Life isn't about jobs, money, clothes, or education. It isn't about keeping score. Life is really about who you love, who you help, and where you make a difference. It's about trust, happiness, compassion, and giving. It's about avoiding jealousy, overcoming ignorance, and building confidence in those around you. It's about seeing people for who they are and not what they are. And most of all, it's about choosing to use your life to touch someone else's. Touch someone else's life and help them in a way that they could never, that could have never been achieved otherwise. Life, my friend, is what you give. These choices are what life's all about. Thanks, Joe, for a compass, my map, teaching me a vision, and showing me what resilience was all about. And that's a chance to do something really special. A special thanks to you folks, June, Lauren, Glenn, and Sharon, their dad. And one final thing, I want everybody to pick up your pamphlet, okay? Everybody got your pamphlet? Joe is going to be proud of this. Okay, everybody look at that pamphlet. I want you to look here, where it says, August 6th, 1930, dash, February 27th, 2015. And what we're here for is that dash. Thanks, Joe.
Kickers. Always telling jokes.
Interesting.
I stand next to Paul McCallum for every Lions game, and all he does is tell jokes. Thank you very much, Dave. That was very inspirational. After Lorne retired as athletic director in 1995, he became the executive director for the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award Program. That program was established in 1982 to commemorate Terry's courage and his tenacity in his cross-Canada Marathon of Hope. The Terry Fox Humanitarian Award recognizes the benevolence of young Canadians and encourages them to continue their humanitarian work while they're attending college or university in Canada. One of the recipients and an alumnus of this prestigious program is Dr. John Kiersey, the Vice President at the University of Manitoba, who joins us now.
Good morning, everybody. I'm for sure glad that I didn't wear my University of Manitoba swag here this morning. But I will say that it's a pleasure to be here with the Simon Fraser community and, of course, Lauren's family, and I feel like I'm in a classroom this morning. I've always felt I was in a classroom with Lorne Davies, and this morning his friends and his family gathering together tells me that that classroom will never end. So thank you for being here this morning. Thank you to the family for inviting me to be a part of this. Lorne Davies' name first came to my attention in 1985 when I was named as a recipient of the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award. And it was in 2011, only 2011, that Lorne and I met for the first time. I was sitting in a restaurant in Vancouver waiting nervously to meet Mr. Lorne Davies. Mr. Davies arrived. And in addition to that grace and that charm, my initial impression, like Glenn's, was, wow, he is much shorter than I would have expected. But within 30 minutes of our conversation, it was clear to me that I was sitting with a giant of a human being with a massive ring on his finger. I came to believe and realize that Lauren is one of those chosen ones, one of those people who are blessed and is surrounded by greatness because he instills greatness in other people. A mere 9 months ago in Winnipeg, Terry Fox's birthplace at the University of Manitoba, spring convocation celebrations held in our gym, much like this, I read a citation that told the story of a great man worthy of the highest recognition bestowed by the university, an honorary doctorate degree. He was in very good company last year. Only a handful of these honorary degrees are given out each year. And last year, CBC commentator Chantal Hébert, Supreme Court Justice Rosalie Abella, former Scotiabank CEO Rick Waugh, and NFL star athlete Israel Adonijé were amongst those recipients in 2014. Right. Surrounded by members of his family and board and the board members of the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award Program, Lauren became Dr. Lorne Davies. He delivered a powerful, stirring, moving address to our students, faculty, and our community. And afterwards, scores of students and parents approached him to shake his hand and thank him for his inspiring words. I wouldn't have imagined in that short period of time that my next face-to-face visit with members of Lauren's family would be today. June, Lauren Jr., Glenn, your families, the University of Manitoba, Chancellor Harvey Sector and President David Bonnard, and our entire university community extends our condolences to you. We also extend our condolences to our colleagues and members of Simon Fraser University community. We share your loss. On behalf of the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award Program and the hundreds of award recipients, I not only offer our condolences, but I thank you for sharing Lauren with us. For the first 30 years of Dr. Davies' career, he worked with the finest athletes in the country, the best of the best, some to go on to become Olympians. And for the next 18 years, Dr. Davies impacted the lives of young Canadians, Terry Fox Humanitarian Award recipients, who are today leaders in business, medicine, sports, science, engineering, arts, education, the list goes on, some becoming Rhodes Scholars. Terry Fox scholar and board member John Rocha spoke to me about Dr. Davies' commitment and his grace. His commitment to the Terry Fox Scholars Program was reflected in his ability to secure an additional $10 million in federal government support, as well as initiating the One More Award program to encourage philanthropic support from scholarship recipients and friends of the program. Dr. Davies' grace was seen in every interaction with award recipients, especially those whose medical challenges prevented them from continuing on with the program or even with school. And in some cases, being a close friend to families who lost their child to their illness. Susan Christofferson, also a Terry Fox Award recipient and board member, highlighted the commitment to equality that Dr. Davies held for all young people, regardless of their gender. This wasn't a late in life phenomenon for Dr. Davies. He was a trailblazer, as we heard today, in the 1960s, when his gold standard of athletic funding applied to men and women, both receiving equal access to coaching, equipment, and scholarship. And that's a worthy note on today, International Women's Day. The chair of the Terry Fox Humanitarian Award Program is Dr. John McFarlane. And John shared in many of Lauren's final days with his family. John told me how Lauren's playful sense of humor that we've heard about this morning will be a part of his lasting impression. John said, no matter what the situation, Lauren found time and the words to inject humor into the mix. Humor is certainly one of the characteristics that stands out for me. I was with the University of Manitoba President Dr. David Bonnard when he called to ask Lauren if he would accept an honorary degree. Lauren was surprised, humbled, gracious, thrilled, all of what you would expect. 20 minutes later, Lauren called me on my mobile and asked me if what had just happened actually just happened. I assured him it did, and he said, but John, why me? I responded, Lauren, you have an amazing body of work that should be praised and celebrated, and this way it will be. To which he replied without a pause, well, at this age, this body doesn't get much praising and celebrating, so I'll take it. Thank you. In 2005, I was introduced to a poem by the Irish poet Micheál O'Shiel. When I first heard the poem, and many times after, I would think of Terry Fox. I've always associated the poem with Terry. And this past week, while reflecting on the life of Lorne Davies, this poem came to mind once more. So I want to share it with you today. It has a Japanese title, Shido, leading. It's broken into three parts. The first, hand. From the Yellow River to Japan, a learning how generations of brushstrokes could signal leadership in two characters allied. She, a finger or pointing, a hand alongside, a sign for tasty or simply good, whose sound may well suggest branch or bough. She with do, above a symbol for the way or tau, below a measure and understood as a sage or skillful hand to lead or guide. Two, hands on, headway of a vessel in rhythm. Let the sea roar and all that fills it still to tune and trim, and believe a crew's feedback that feeds forward, a kinship of feeling when to harden or slack, trusting nothing can overwhelm, wonder of moving in phase and yet a lone hand at the helm. Three, hand over, to give it all, and still the wisdom to know how things nurtured steer from inside, to praise and let go, a stage well run, to call it then a day, and time a perfect handing over. At the crux of a relay, one peaks as another hits his stride, a baton slid from hand to hand, glory of standing aside. Dr. Lorne Davies, your sage and skillful hand has pointed the way. Your commitment, dedication, passion, humor, and grace has shown us all how it's done. You've passed the baton. I and countless others accept that baton and commit to continuing your journey. And to you, Lorne, we are forever grateful. You truly gave it your all. Thank you.
Thank you, John. Our next speaker, Wayne Holm, has often been described as Lorne's third son, which means he didn't have to run the hill 38 times. Ran at 37. He played football at SFU from 1966 to 1969. He was named SFU's Athlete of the Year that final year, and he was also named Sports Canada's All-Canadian Football Team. In 1970, Wayne was the first overall pick in the Canadian Football League draft. He had a four-year CFL career where he played with Calgary, BC, and Toronto before his career was cut short in 1973 because of a knee injury. Since finishing his football career, Wayne has embarked on a successful career in the restaurant industry with the Keg, Milestones, and many other restaurants. Please welcome Wayne Holm.
Well, thank you, June. I'm not sure that I should really thank you for this at this point in time, seeing the cast of characters that have been preceding me here. I'm honored to be speaking today, and the third son reference is one of the proudest things in my history here that I've heard about myself. However, to be included in the Davies family, you're not always just quite there yet. You have to realize, as Lorne Jr. announced to me, that he and Glenn retain veto rights. So behave, Wayne. He also reminded me today that when he called to ask me to speak, that it was a good news and bad news thing. We'd like you to speak, but we have you last on the agenda. And you need to know that there are some really, 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 really good speakers before you. And then he chuckled and looked right at me and said, "Don't blow it." Not far from the tree, huh? Being a father and a proud parent of four boys of my own, I've never had to look very far to find the ideal role models of the parent I aspired to be. All I had to do was to observe Lorne and June as they lived their lives fully committed to God, family, and their fellow man. But the part of the relationship that I admired most was Lorne and June's partnership and their incredible and unfailing love for each other. It was pure magic to see how they transferred that love steeped in the right values so successfully to their boys, to their grandchildren, and now the great-grandchildren, the beautiful Brielle, and the newest arrival, the mighty Isaac. Lorne had many gifts, but one of his greatest was loyalty and a commitment to his relationships. And if you were lucky enough to be a friend of Lorne, you were a friend for life. Lorne has been there for me in so many critical junctions in my life. So June, I'm sorry, but I probably still have a few screw-ups left. So you're going to have to pick up the ball for Lorne and guide me as wisely as he did. Lorne and June are very connected to my family, especially my 97-year-old mom, considers herself one of Lorne's best friends, who wishes she could be here today, but health prevents that. I shared with Lorne Jr. during one of our recent hospital visits that my mom wanted Lorne to pass away before her because she knew without a doubt that he would go to heaven and that she needed him there to help pave the way for her. What we're all going to miss about Lorne is that wit. Over the years, I've had many opportunities to speak about Lorne and share some of my favorite Joe Lorne stories. He is so topical, it seems like a life journey when you're thinking about him. The most recent was at the 50th annual alumni football dinner, and he almost always spoke after me. He was never unkind, but more than equalized any joke advantage he thought that you had gained. So for example, today, my good buddy Dave Cutler spoke before me. Very well, by the way, David. But of course, is guilty of stealing all of my material. But he made the fatal mistake of allowing me to speak last. So, if Lorne were here today, we know it would go something like this, right, Dave? You know, that Dave was a good kid. A kid who desperately wanted to be a linebacker. But if you thought Lorne was short, Dave was a little shorter. Not very big, and actually not a very good athlete. So I asked myself, what can I do for a kid like this? So I found this old shoe with a square toe and a string, and I said, David, why don't you try kicking? So he, of course, became a Hall of Fame field goal kicker, and he owes it all to me. The facts don't matter really much in this situation with Lorne. It's just that he got the last shot in. And for the record, Dave was a very good linebacker, not a very good athlete. Lorne's humor was his way of keeping us all, especially me, humble. In the 50 years that I've known him, the shots never relented. At the 50th annual alumni dinner, I shared this example, and it was last fall that he and June came out to watch my 12-year-old son, Nathan, play football. And Nate had the game of his life. He returned the opening kickoff for a touchdown, ran three others for a touchdown, had an interception. At the end of the game, Lorne, in a very loud voice, as if to attract attention, certainly intended, he said, Nathan, come over here. Nathan, you know I coached your dad. Yes, Coach Lorne, he said, looking in big, admiring eyes. Well, son, after watching you play today, I've got to tell you that you are four times the player he ever was. Humbled once again, but laughing along with everyone else, Lorne reached up to whisper in my ear, "Wayne, he wasn't four times better, he was actually five times better." I always felt a special bond with Lorne, only to so often discover so did so many others. But put that aside, he is still the person who had the greatest influence in my life. He set the mark for me as a husband, although it took me two times to get it right. And now, after 15 years, my estimate to reach his and June's incredible 60-year high mark, well, I'd be 112. And some would say that's a lofty goal, but not Lorne. He would say, "Wayne, go for it." Lorne also set the standard for so many of us as a leader. Whatever he did, whether coaching or playing, administering at the university, or the Terry Fox Foundation, he did with a passion and commitment to do his very best and inspired us to do the same. He was a firm believer that leaders were made, not born. It is something that you knowingly have to want to be, and you need to be willing to suffer some hard lessons to get there. And the road is littered with failures, he would constantly remind me. And Lorne, in knowing this, it became the reason why he drove us so hard to find our inner strengths. He taught us about integrity, and I've heard it said that integrity is a powerful force. It keeps you alive to others long after you've left, so it will be with Lorne. No question that the athlete and person that he was proudest of was Terry Fox. Terry embodied everything that Lorne held dear in life. Having heard from the Fox family this morning, you can see how they held Lorne in equal high regard. Lorne's reputation as a coach fell to, let's gently say, some rumors. Some embellished stories of harsh treatment, like that first Trout Lake practice you've heard about, where people ran and ran and ran. Well, Lorne would tell you that's what you're supposed to do in football. Or the old alumni stories of running the hill after hill, or the 2.5-hour practices in the scoring heat or the pouring rain, and then doing them all over again because, Glenn, was it you that didn't run up the hill? Lorne would say, "Finish the job, men. There can be no cracks in the chain." So yes, based on the number of times you've heard these stories referred to today, years do allow for some embellishment, but they are the things of legend, the things we now treasure, and from whence came our greatest lessons. I'm going to end with one of the hundreds of incredible emails that have come into the family since the news of Lorne's hospitalization and passing. There's one that Lorne Jr., Glenn, and June felt best captured what so many people have tried to express about their experience with Lorne. And this was from Bob Smith, the inaugural 96-5 class, also a J.O. man. "Dear Lorne and June, last December I was listening to the finest man I've ever known talking to a room full of athletes about a team he had coached and what made them successful. One of the phrases that resonated most deeply with me were these words, 'We were tougher than them.' And then louder, 'We were tougher than them.' It wasn't said to describe any kind of a bullying behavior or an attitude, but rather was a mindset. A mindset that I know he instilled in hundreds of ordinary young men just like I was when I first met him. He taught us and made us believe that no matter how difficult or daunting the task or circumstances you are faced with, you always have an inner reserve or strength or resolve to get through it. And if you gave everything you had, you always would succeed. that it was the trying that made you a winner and a success, not the points on the scoreboard. Although he would remind us that if those points were in the wrong order, then maybe there still might be some room for further effort. That fellow, of course, I'm talking about is you, Lorne. And even though I am an older man now, I'm still guided by what you taught me. Bob, thank you for expressing so articulately and honestly what so many of us have tried to express. We're all better for having known Lorne. Lorne's loss has led me to some reflecting on my own life, especially after hearing the recurring themes running through many of the stories and the words shared here today. I'm reminded by these stories that I want to be better, that I must make more time for my family, my sons, and my wife. I need to find more ways to love my fellow man if I'm to fully honor Lorne's past. Lorne Jr. shared a story with me of his dad's ministry at his church, and that Lorne Sr. most often would end up with the toughest cases. But he embraced each of those challenges willingly and never walked away, no matter how big. The magic of Lorne is that he took the time, even if it was just a moment, to make us all feel special and of value to him. It was a pretty simple formula to just give unselfishly. And to those of us he touched, he gifted us with a belief in self and gave us the inspiration to be our best. The gift we could give back to honor Lorne is to pass his uplifting magic on. Give unselfishly, give your best. Like his son Glenn did with me at one of my low points during Lorne's last days. Wayne said, "Don't be sad, be happy." I'm not following the advice here. Dad had the wonderful life he had, living it full to the brim. And what an ending. How many of us could have ever hoped to have had the recognition and celebrations that he experienced in this last year? A year to go out on that the rest of us can only dream about. So right, Glenn. What a life, what a man. Thank you, and God bless you, Lorne and Davies family.
Thank you, Wayne. I'd now like to ask one of Lorne's sons, Lorne Jr., to come up and say a few words.
Wow. On behalf of my mother, my brother, myself, our family, and most important, my father, I want to thank you all for coming out today to honor his memory. I know he would have been very touched by seeing you all here today. I want to thank Farhan, Pastor Register, Milton, Jim, Glenn, Fred Fox. Dave, I don't know about. Dave. John and Wayne for doing such a wonderful job speaking today. And a special thank you to Milton and your staff, Peg Johnson, Gloria Chu, their staffs, the pipe band, and everybody involved in doing such an outstanding job in organizing this celebration of my father's life. My dad really cared about Simon Fraser University. He cared about the students, the faculty, the staff, the coaches, the athletes, and the alumni. This service today shows how much all of you loved and cared about him, and how much Simon Fraser University loved and cared about him. Today he's gone to a better place, and today we celebrate the time we had with him. But understand this, He cared greatly about Simon Fraser, and he still cares about Simon Fraser. Even though physically he's not here, his spirit will always remain on this mountaintop. God bless my father, and God bless Simon Fraser University.
Thank you, Lorne. Ladies and gentlemen, I'd ask that you join me in taking a special look back at the life of Lorne Davies.
The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Going your way. see the world. There's such a lot of world to see. We're after the same rainbow's end, waiting round the bend. My huckleberry friend, Moon River, and me.
Bring something up right now. Okay? I promise, and most of you know.
There's Grandpa. Perfect form.
Lorne's last year was an incredible one. He became Dr. Lorne Davies, and he was the honoree at the SFU football 50th anniversary banquet. Lorne is survived by his wife June, his son Lorne Jr., and daughter-in-law Karen, his son Glenn, and daughter-in-law Melody, his five grandchildren, J.R., Christopher, Michael, Crystal, and Morgan, and his two great-grandchildren, Brielle and Isaac.
Kind of wish we'd shown that at the beginning. I would like to thank everybody here for coming. I also personally would like to thank June and Lorne Jr. and Glenn for allowing me to be a part of this very special day to pay tribute to a very special man. The family will be greeting guests at a reception in the central gym where tea and coffee and light refreshments will be served. The pipe band will escort the family now, and they will also perform afterwards, and I'd like to invite all of you to follow in behind as we head next door and continue to share some memories and some stories about Lorne Davies. Thanks again, everyone, for attending.